Penguin Random House Audio presents Overthrow by Caleb Crain, read for you by Ari Fliakos. To Peter. You may my glories and my state depose, but not my griefs, still am I king of those. Richard II. 1. It was a few days after the clocks had fallen back for the end of daylight saving time, during the interval when people have adjusted their schedules, but not yet their habits. A graduate student in English named Matthew Fisher was walking home from the subway. Dusk had caught the houses along the street with their blinds still undrawn, and living room after living room was exposed, glowing in bright display. Was it wrong to look into them? It was like looking into lives that one wasn't going to get to live. Matthew saw a toy sailboat on top of a television. He saw a sweater folded over the back of a chair. When he saw a pine cone on a mantelpiece, for a moment he seemed to see the room that contained the pine cone from the pine cone's point of view, as if he, too, were surrounded by the bright yellow cheer that belonged to the family that lived there. And then he was himself again. Outside in the dark, walking. He had a beard, which he had grown after he had turned 30, just over a year ago, in the hope that it would make him a little harder to read. He was pretty sure that he did now look a little bearish. In one of his online profiles, he claimed to have a boxer's build, which wasn't completely misrepresentative. According to a man he had recently picked up in a bar, he looked like the sort of person who could work for a long time without getting sick. He hadn't called the man again afterward. He was a little alone in the world at the moment, as it happened. He had fallen behind in writing his dissertation, and his close friends in the program, including a man he'd been seeing, hadn't. They had finished in the spring and then left for jobs and fellowships in other parts of the country over the summer. He had stayed in touch with some of them by email, and he and the now amicably former boyfriend talked now and then by phone. He hadn't foreseen how hard it would be to replace a number of friends at once, exactly when one was supposed to be conserving one's energies for research and writing. Nor had he foreseen that not having people in one's life would make it much more difficult to take in new ones. Under the circumstances, any single new person seemed to carry somehow too much presence. Tonight, though, he noticed that he seemed able to send some of himself out into the world. Halfway down the block, he became aware of a young man on a skateboard, pushing down the sidewalk toward him. 23? 24? The boy was wearing a gray toggle coat. Against the dim evening, his face and bare hands were almost luminous. He had a sort of elfin beauty, Matthew saw as the boy came nearer, a fine nose, thin lips, eyes like little candies. A few yards from Matthew, the boy kicked up his skateboard and carried it. The dismounting might have been no more than urban politeness, but when his eyes met Matthew's, they had a sly look. And Matthew heard himself saying hi. "Oh, hi," the skateboarder replied, stopping in his tracks. It was always startling that it turned out to be so easy. For a moment, Matthew didn't know what to say. The boy was taller than Matthew was. "You can say it," said the skateboarder. "Say what?" Matthew wondered aloud. "I'm on my way to a friend's. Do you want to come?" "Is he a skater like you?" "She? No. She. She's straight, even." "I remember straight people," said Matthew. The boy continued to carry his skateboard, and Matthew, reversing direction, fell into step beside him. The skateboarder said his name was Leaf. He had been skating at the late 19th-century monument at the park entrance a block away. Matthew was familiar with it. A marble ledge at the back served as a bench, and skaters liked to pop their boards into the air and surf along the bench's edge, as if filing it down by skidding along it. The marble was soft, and Matthew had noticed that they were in fact filing it down unevenly. He always felt a little protective of a thing if it spoke of the past. The city had trained him to be a connoisseur, and he could tell that this boy, with his nonchalance and moonglow complexion, outclassed him. Still, he was used to getting more than he deserved, and there wasn't any evidence of unwillingness. In a few minutes, he might be grabbing the tousled hair at the back of the boy's head and kissing him. He was aware, however, that as they walked, his own apartment was receding behind them, along with the prospect of dinner. "Where are you taking me?" Matthew asked.
"Down the rabbit hole."
Uh-oh.
"No, not really."
"Drink me, I hope," Matthew hinted.
"Subtle."
"I mean, drink you, as it were," Matthew clarified. "That you're a tall drink of water, or whatever."
"As it were,"
the young man echoed. "Not that that's any more subtle," Matthew admitted. He didn't believe in dignity, at least not where the pursuit of boys was concerned. The skateboarder, for his part, accepted the compliment without acknowledgement, and Matthew realized that he knew he wanted the boy without knowing yet whether he liked him. The boy might be stringing Matthew along merely for the pleasure of manifesting the power of his own beauty.
"You're sweet,"
the boy offered. "No, I'm not," Matthew replied. In pickups, there were always small frustrations and disappointments, such as delay, that one had to decide what to do with. If they added up too quickly, one could decide to set against them not only the pleasure that, if all went well, one was about to have, but also the revenge of never seeing the man again afterward. In case he might want to see the man again, however, in case the latest boy might turn out to be the one for whom he was willing to break the pattern of solitude that he had fallen into, Matthew always tried, for as long as he could, for a while anyway, to turn aside any verdict that negative impressions of the boy might have led him to by sorting them, along with positive ones, into a picture or story that was, at least tentatively, worth holding on to. That is, he tried, as he assembled the picture or story, to see in it someone he might be interested in or even able to fall for. Someone he could imagine looking back at the picture with. They turned onto one of the quiet residential avenues.
"What do you do?"
the skateboarder asked. "Do you skateboard a lot?" Matthew countered, because he didn't feel like explaining about kingship in early modern English poetry yet. The boy coughed. It began almost as a hiccup, but sank quickly into a rough hacking, low in the chest, and the boy had trouble mastering it.
"Sorry," he said when he had his breath again. "I meant to laugh at you, not cough at you."
He took a plastic water bottle out of his coat pocket and swigged from it. "Do you smoke?"
"I caught pneumonia at Occupy. I'm just getting over it."
"Should you be out in the cold? Are you even wearing a sweater under that?"
"I thought you weren't sweet. Here it is."
They had come to one of the stolid corner lot apartment buildings, pre-war, gray stone with elegant cornices that were still just a little too large for the rich to convert to single-family residences and persisted, therefore, as refuges for young strivers. The best part of picking people up, Matthew sometimes thought, was seeing the insides of strangers' homes, the apartments of people that a grad student in English might otherwise not even get to talk to.
"It's me,"
the skateboarder told the intercom. At the back of a black-and-white tiled lobby, a staircase twisted up tightly and steeply, and on the first landing, Matthew caught up to the skateboarder. His name was Leaf, Matthew reminded himself, and kissed him. The boy gave more than the porcelain delicacy of his looks suggested that he would. Afterward, his face was flushed, Matthew saw. They kissed again.
"You're perfect," Matthew said.
The boy smiled with concern. He had a girl's eyelashes and very faint freckles.
"Are you drunk?"
he asked Matthew, unseriously. On the third floor, a door had been left ajar, and the skateboarder walked in without knocking and without waiting to see if Matthew followed him.
I brought someone, he hollered as he strode down a dark, narrow corridor, which, according to a paradoxical layout typical of pre-war buildings in the neighborhood, revealed the private spaces of the apartment before the public ones.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.